I want you to repeat after me. Don't waste it. Say it again. Don't waste it. Put that in the comment section. You guys can be seated. I want to tag this text with that topic. Don't waste it. I want to give somebody watching me today, somebody in the room right now, somewhat of an announcement, somewhat of a notification on your phone. I need you to remember this summer, everywhere you go in life, you're blessed. No matter who doesn't like you and who does, I need you to remember, you're blessed. When you go in work and they are working you like the CEO but paying you like the janitor, I want you to remind yourself of those two words, I'm blessed. When people who you love walk away from you with no explanation at all, I want you to look them in the face and say, you know what, I'm blessed. Because there is a peace that comes with knowing that no matter what happens in your life, God has blessed you, all right? Now, somebody's watching me saying, well, Pastor Hollis, I certainly don't feel blessed. Yes, it's possible for you to feel one way while still being something else. It's possible for you to be going through one of the worst seasons of your life and God still to look at you and call you blessed. I'm getting ready to mess somebody up. It's possible for you to be going through a bankruptcy and still be blessed. It is possible for you to have lost some loved ones and still be blessed. Why? Because first and foremost, I'm blessed because I woke up this morning. I'm blessed because God started me on my way. I'm blessed because he clothed me in my right mind. I'm blessed because I've got the activity of all of my limbs. I'm blessed because when I want to get up and walk out the door, I can do it. I need somebody to shout, I'm blessed. I'm blessed. But a part of wisdom, AJ, is warning, all right? A part of wisdom is warning. And if we're going to apply wisdom to this blessed life, then we've got to realize that it's possible for you to be blessed and be wasteful at the same time. I think I'm getting ready to mess somebody up today. One of the biggest issues that many of us have is that we discount, we downgrade, we delimit the blessing that God has put on our life. Why? Because we're wasteful. Somebody shout, don't waste it. All right, here's something I want you to write down. This is the first thing I want you to write down today. It's hard to be wealthy when you're wasteful. Is that good? It's hard to be wealthy when you're wasteful. Many of us do not even realize we have not grasped in totality the life that we could be living because we're so tempted to be wasteful. Think about that prodigal son. The Bible says that he spent all he had on riotous, wasteful living. He didn't even understand that as soon as he demanded his birthright, as soon as he demanded his inheritance from his father, it automatically decreased what he could have gotten. He limited the blessing on his life because he was in such a rush to be wasteful. And it is impossible to be wealthy and wasteful at the same time. I need somebody to grab this. I want to be blessed and paid. I want to be able to speak in tongues and have a divorce portfolio. I want to be blessed in the bedroom and in the boardroom. I want to be blessed in the bank account. I want to be blessed when I come and I go. But I will never live the blessed life God has called me to as long as I am wasteful. I want to tell somebody who's watching me right now, don't waste the anointing that God has put over your life. Don't waste those prayers that people pray for you when you couldn't even pray for yourself. Don't waste the calling and the anointing and the purpose and the creativity that God has planted inside of you. Don't waste it. I've reached a place in my life where I am so in love with what I believe God can do through me that I am refusing to waste it. If I gotta wake up early, I will, because I can't waste it. If I gotta stay up late, I will. Why? Because I can't waste it. If nobody else supports me, you can catch me supporting myself. Why? Because I can't waste it. I need somebody in the comment section to declare that I cannot waste it. I can't waste it. When you're blessed, you realize that you're too blessed to waste the blessing. You're too blessed to waste the blessing. When you really realize the amount of grace that God has given you, I can't preach to everybody because there's so many people who think you're perfect and you've dotted every I and crossed every T, but some of us are crazy enough to know that it was nothing but the grace and favor of God that has covered and kept us. I can't waste his grace. I can't waste his favor. I can't waste it. It's hard to be wealthy and wasteful at the same time. Right? If you're going to live a blessed life, you cannot be wasteful. I need you to grab that, okay? I really need you to grab that. And too oftentimes, we pray for what we want while wasting what we have. Did you hear what I just said? Too many times, D-Ree, too many times, AJ Denzel, we pray for what we want while simultaneously wasting what we have. And I believe before God gives you what you want, he first checks to see how you're handling what you already have. I can put Bible on it. My Bible says, be faithful over a few, and then I'll make you ruler over many. And too many times we're asking for God to give us more when he's looking at the way we've handled what we already have. And he says, baby, I love you, but I can't give you what's next until you properly handle what's now. I really want you to grasp this, that too many times we pray for what we want while simultaneously wasting what we have. Can you tag somebody right quick in the comment section and tell them don't waste it? Look at somebody next to you and tell them don't waste it. You're believing God for too much in the future for you to waste what you have right now. You're believing God for too much tomorrow for you to waste away today. You can't waste it. You can't waste it. And blessed people have learned not to waste. I want to suggest that as we all move a little bit closer to being who God has called us to be, we can only do that if we stop wasting the blessings that we already have. As I prepare for our time together today, I thought about a couple ways we waste the various blessings that God gives us, all right? I want you to put this in your notes. Number one, some of us are wasteful with the blessings of God because we assume we deserve God's blessings. Say amen or say ouch. When I'm preaching, it's sort of the same thing. Some of us are wasting the blessings that God has given us because we are arrogant enough to assume we deserve them. I thought 100 people were going to log off right then. They're like, nah, I'll just catch next week. I don't want to hear that. Many of us are wasting what God has given us because we have the arrogant assumption that we deserve it. This shows up in our life as wasted time. This shows up in our life as wasted time. See, when I assume that I deserve the opportunities and the blessings that God brings into my life, I'll be wasteful over them because I already assume that the blessings of God are like a bus. You know, if you miss one bus, you don't trip because another one coming back around. I remember a couple years ago when I was flying for work, and y'all got to pray for me. I missed my layover. Timeliness has never been a quality that God has given me. And if it was, I guess I ignored it, right? And so I was on my way to the airport. I was late for my first flight, but I made it just in time. And, you know, you got that connecting flight, right? And so I'm in the airport, and y'all got to pray for me. I'm a country boy from Alabama. I hadn't been anywhere, so I'm in a Baltimore airport, and I'm seeing all these different shops and restaurants and all this other stuff. And so I'm stopping, going in there, and I'm checking out this restaurant, and I'm going in there. And then before I knew it, I looked up and I realized I was missing my boarding time, right? Now, what's crazy is that when I went up to the front to talk to the attendant, she said, well, Mr. Thomas, we can get you on another flight, but you're going to have to wait. All right, let me slide this back because I don't want anybody to throw anything through their TV screen at me. She said, Mr. Thomas, we can help you out, but you're going to have to wait. All right. Now, this is critical because I ended up getting to my final destination 5 or 6 hours later than I should have. All right. I want to tell somebody that part of the reason why you feel this pressure as though you're behind schedule and you're not where you should be. You should have been further by now. You should have been have accomplished more by now. Part of that pressure comes from knowing that I assume that I deserve the blessings that God had given me. And because I assume that I deserved it, I wasted time. And when I wasted time, I delayed the destiny that God had for me because I assumed that I was going to always have another chance. I need to tell somebody in the room, somebody who's watching me right now, you can't waste no more time. I don't know who that was for, but I need you to go in the comment section and say, Pastor Hollis, I received that. You cannot waste any more time. You are too anointed to keep wasting time. I know they cute, but before y'all go on a date, you need to sit them down and say, now listen, I know you're cute. You got a nice job. I like you, but are you going to waste my time? Because I've been into too many relationships that I thought were going somewhere only for them to end up not going anywhere. I can't waste no more time. Can I tell a college student there's too much waiting on you for you to keep wasting time partying and kicking it? You can't waste time. There's too much God is trying to do in your life for you to keep wasting time. You can't waste any more time. We cannot operate under the assumption that we're going to have another chance. When we waste the blessing of time, we assume that God will give us more time to do tomorrow what he already called us to do today. Can you receive that? When we waste the blessing of time, we arrogantly assume that God will give us more time tomorrow to do what he already gave us time to do today. You got to stop wasting time. Look at somebody, tell them, stop wasting time. Drop that in the comment section. Tell them, stop wasting time. Tomorrow's not promised. I can't waste no time. Tomorrow is a promise. I can't wait. Start the business today because you can't waste no more time. Get back in school today because you cannot waste time. Go to counseling. Start praying. Get in your word more. Be serious about your calling because you cannot waste time. All right? So some of us, we waste the blessings of God because we assume that we deserve them. But number two, some of us fail to steward God's blessings. We fail to steward God's blessing. This is good, all right? This shows up in our life looking like wasted talent. I'm talking if you're listening, all right? So when we assume that we deserve the blessings of God, that causes us to waste time. But when we fail to steward the blessings of God, that causes us to waste talent. Jesus Christ. I remember growing up being a high school athlete, and I was blessed to be able to be on some really pretty good teams. Our junior year, we went to the Final Four. I was probably like the 6th or 7th best player on the team, but it was great teams. I was surrounded by great talent. And it never failed that we would play a team that I knew should have beat us, but we would wind up blowing them out by 20 or 30. And I'm sitting back trying to figure out, those guys were faster than us. They were taller than us. They were more athletic than us. How are we able to beat them? Because they had the talent, but they didn't have the work ethic. Y'all missing me. And one of the worst things, see, I'm going to tell you what I'm tired of hearing. You got potential. That was cute like 7 years ago. I don't want nobody else telling me about my potential, because eventually I'm going to start feeling as though if you keep telling me all the potential I have, that must mean I'm not doing anything right now. Am I wasting my talent? Am I wasting my talent? That's a question I need you to ask yourself as you travel through this next week. Am I wasting my talent? Am I making the most out of what God has given me? Or am I allowing my abilities, my giftings, my callings, my leanings to go to waste? Some of us fail to steward God's blessings. That shows up in our life looking like wasted talent. That's good. We waste God's blessings when we fail to put them to work. I want to show you this in the Bible. Look at Matthew chapter 25, verse 26. Then the man who had received one bag of gold came. Master, he said, I know that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered. This man, you know this parable. This is the parable of the talent, where this man gives away talent. He goes on a far journey. When he comes back, he wants to see what type of return has he got on his investment. And so there's one brother who's made the most of his opportunity. He's multiplied the talent that was given to him. It's another brother who, while he didn't do as good as the first man, he still made something out of what he was given. And then there's this last lazy servant who, instead of putting to work what the man had given him, he buries it. All right? Now you're looking at me saying, I don't bury my gift, but you're still sitting on that idea. No, I'm not burying my gift, but you still haven't written that book. No, I'm not burying my gift, but you still haven't done the hard work that it's going to take for you to become the man or woman that God has called you to be. Why are you taking what God has given you and burying it? No, God doesn't want you to bury it. He wants you to plant it. Y'all didn't hear what I just said. God doesn't want you to bury it. He wants you to plant it. Because you bury what's dead, you plant something because you're expecting it to grow. I don't know who I'm talking to, but you are no longer allowed to bury the talent that God has put in you. You cannot allow it to go to waste. No, you've got to plant that seed because God is expecting to reap a harvest. Y'all not hearing what I'm saying. God is expecting a return on his investment, and I cannot allow you. I wouldn't be who I am if I went home today without irritating or motivating you into realizing you can't waste your talent. You cannot waste it. This is so good. God expects that every blessing he gave you, you're going to use it to bless somebody else. Did you hear what I just said? God is expecting every blessing that he gave you that you're going to turn around and put it to work so that you can bless somebody else. Y'all didn't see this coming, which now means, let's do this deductively, which now means that if you're the only one being blessed by your talent, you're still wasting it. Y'all not hearing me today. If you're the only person that's being blessed by your talent, then you're still wasting it. You mean to tell me you take professional photographs and you ain't volunteered at your church once? Wasted talent. You mean to tell me you've been doing hair in your kitchen since you were 13 and you've never decided to give somebody a free hairstyle? Wasted talent. Wasted talent. Wasted talent. Wasted talent. If you are the only person who is being blessed by your ability, then you're still wasting it. Why? Thank you, Pastor Mike, because apple trees don't eat apples. Y'all don't like me today. We waste God's blessings because we assume that we deserve them. Number two, we fail to steward God's blessings, right? But then number three, we waste them because some of us overlook God's blessings. We overlook God's blessings. This shows up in our life as wasted treasure. We waste time, we waste talent, but then sometimes we waste treasure. When we overlook God's blessings, it shows up in our life looking like wasted treasure. When you are preoccupied with what you want, you will always overlook what you have. Y'all are not listening to me today. When you are so preoccupied with what you want, you will overlook what you already have. God has never done a blessing with what you want. Every blessing he's ever done has been with what you already have. I want you to look in your Bible and show me one miracle that God did, one miracle that Jesus performed that was based upon what somebody wished they had. Yeah, y'all not hearing me. It's 5,000 men out there, not counting the women and children. Jesus, they've been with us all week. They've been traveling with us everywhere we go. What we gonna do? They hungry. We can't send them home like that. He didn't say, man, I wish I had 10,000 chicken wings and 5,000 biscuits and a couple gallons of sweet tea and lemonade. No, he said, what do you have? No, it's just a little boy out there with a last lunch. Don't trip on that. Bring me what you have, and I will do a miracle with what's in your hand. I don't know who I'm preaching to. I'm getting fired up. But you better stop waiting on tomorrow and give God what's already in your hand. If you give him what's in your hand, he can make a miracle. If you give him what's in your hand, he can do what eyes have not seen and what ears have not heard. Give him what's in your hand. God has never waited for what you wanted. He's always used what you have. Can I tell you something else? If we don't appreciate what we have, time will force us to appreciate what we had. I'm talking, if we do not appreciate what we have, then time will force us to appreciate what we had. Tell me that you're not tired of looking back on your life, wishing that you had done something because you wasted the moment that God had given you. I don't have any more time for regret and resentment and what I wish I had done. No, starting today, I'm not gonna waste it. Starting today, I can't waste it. Starting today, I can't give it up. I know you cute, but if being with you is gonna cause me to waste what God is trying to do in my life, then may the Lord watch between me and thee while we are absent one from another. Why? Because I can't waste it. I can't waste it. This is critical. You gotta catch this. You cannot waste this, because time will force you to realize, listen to me, that if I will not appreciate what I have, time will force me to appreciate what I had. There are so many of us who are so firmly rooted in regret and resentment. Because at the end of the day, we are grieving what we wasted. I'm talking to somebody and I need you to get free today. There are too many of us that are still living in 2011 and 2015 because we are grieving what we wasted. And now you are forced to be appreciative in retrospect. Did you hear what I just said? Now you're forced to be appreciative in retrospect. I didn't appreciate it when I had it. And so now 10 years later, I'm trying to get, you know, I just appreciate. This is why, oh, I'm about to get myself in trouble. This is why you ain't been with them in 10 years, but they still DMing you. Say amen or say ouch. Because they didn't appreciate you when they had you. And now time has taught them, man, she was really a good girl. Man, bro was all right. We could have made that work. But when you don't appreciate it in the moment, you end up missing it. When you don't appreciate it in the moment, you end up missing it. This is so good. This is so good. Every once in a while, you just got to start telling God, God, thank you. God, I don't want to look back 10 years from now and realize I never told you thank you. I was getting ready to complain the other day, and I was sitting there talking to my wife, and I realized what I was complaining about today, what I was getting ready to complain about today, is the same thing I prayed for 10 years ago. All right, God, this is good. Some of us overlook, somebody shout overlook. Overlook. We overlook God's blessings. When we look at Esau's narrative in Genesis chapter 25, I believe his life is a warning against wasting. I believe it's a warning against wasting. Look at Genesis chapter 25, verse 29. Once when Jacob was cooking some stew, Esau came in from the open country famished. This is good, and on my first, the first time I looked at this text, Jason, I didn't see anything in this, but I realized that there was really something leaping out of it at me. Y'all know Pastor Mike, he's trained us to be exegetically nosy, that we know how to properly harmonize our hermeneutics with relevant homiletics. In other words, we need our Bible to preach. And when I looked at that word famished, I thought to myself, that's just a $2 word for hungry. This is a $2 word for hunger. This is so good, and I really need you to catch this. In other words, he comes back home from hunting, and he's hungry. Bible says he comes back from the open country. When we engage the context, we learn that Esau was an outdoorsman. He liked to hunt and kill wild game. He was his father's favorite, but his twin brother Jacob was his mother's favorite. You know the story of Esau and Jacob. Esau was born first, but Jacob was born after him, holding on to his heel. His name, Jacob, literally means supplanter. This is good. He comes home from hunting, and he's hungry. Are y'all following me? In other words, like my grandmother would say, he's worked up an appetite. He's worked up an appetite, all right? He has a legitimate need for food, Jason. But the enemy loves to tempt us to feel a legitimate need illegitimately. Yeah. Did you catch what I just said? Yeah. Him being hungry is a legitimate need. If you work long enough, you're gonna get hungry. Yeah. Somebody watching me, you eating right now because you're hungry. And what the enemy does is because the enemy does not have any creative capabilities. I'm getting ready to teach you something. The enemy is not a creative. He's not a creator. He's a manipulator. He does not create. He just manipulates what's already been created, right? And so he'll take a legitimate need and then tempt you to fill it illegitimately, right? And so what he does is, look at verse 30. He's hungry. He's got an appetite. Somebody shout appetite. He's got an appetite. Look at verse 30. He said to Jacob, quick, let me have some of that red stew. I'm famished. This is why he's called an Edom. I don't have time to unpack the Edomites and the difference between the Edomites and the Israelites. Edom simply means red, all right? Esau was red. He was hairy. He was an outdoorsman. Edom simply translates to mean red, all right? He comes home. This is dangerous. And because he has an appetite that has not been filled, all right? He comes home and he asks for the first thing that he sees. I'm talking too heavy in here. He doesn't wait to see what's going to be for dinner. He doesn't wait to see if mama's cooked something. He doesn't open up his app and peruse DoorDash and see what he might like to eat. No, he comes home hungry and he grabs and asks for the first thing that he sees. And you getting ready to beat up Esau when I'm in the text, you're in the text, we're all in the text. Because if we're not careful, the devil will tempt us and we'll end up so empty and so hungry and so low on fuel that we'll ask for the first thing that we see. Which is why you knew that relationship wasn't for you, but you had been by yourself for so long that the first person who told you you was cute, now you looked up 2 years later and you trapped in a relationship that's not going anywhere because you took the first thing you saw. He's so hungry when he comes back from the field that the first thing he sees, let me get some of that. Y'all don't like me, but I know I'm teaching. I know I'm teaching. Somebody should just go in the comment section and say amen or say ouch. Pastor Hollis, you preaching to me. He comes home and he's so hungry that he asks for the first thing that he sees. All right, what's the problem in that? Open this up. Help me understand this, Pastor Hollis, all right? He's allowing his appetite to control his actions. He's allowing his appetite to control his actions. Y'all not hearing me. We all got an appetite for something. This ain't the perfect church. No, this is not the perfect church. We keep it real here. I gotta be honest with you. This is not about perfection. It's about progressing. We all have an appetite for something. Many times the appetite that we have something for is not good for who God has called us to be. Can we be honest today? And if you're not careful, you'll allow your appetite to control your actions. He is living on the lowest possible level of life. The lowest level of life is when you walk around being controlled by your appetite. You can't say no to nothing. I'm so hungry, I'm so empty, I'm so unfulfilled that the first thing that makes me feel good about myself, I'll ask for that. I'll sign up for the first group of friends that'll welcome me. Knowing that this is an environment that I don't need to be in, but because I'm so lonely and because I've been by myself and I need companionship and friendship so bad, I'll take the first thing that I got. Why? Because I'm hungry. He's living on the lowest possible level of life. He's being controlled by his appetite. And I need to free somebody who's watching me right now, somebody who's in this room, that you will no longer live life controlled by your appetite. That's why it's so important to be in your word and connect to a life-giving church. That's why it's so important to make sure that you're spending time in prayer and worship. Why? Because when I get up off my knees, I feel filled. And now I'm not as tempted to accept the first thing that somebody gives me. Why? Because I've been filled. I need somebody to go in the comment section and just type, I've been filled. Who I used to be, I'm not that person no more. Why? Because I've been filled. No, baby, I don't like you. I don't want to go on a date. And now that I think about it, you're really not even that cute. I was just empty. There was some stuff that was only attractive to you when you were hungry. Y'all not listening to me. There was some stuff that ceases to be as attractive when you get control over your appetite. Jesus Christ. Do we need to woosah for a minute? That was like, did this take you a 5 second break? Just woosah for a second. Jesus, this is good. All right. I gotta get through this. I gotta hurry. All right. So Pastor Hollis, if I'm not supposed to live my life being controlled by my appetite, what am I supposed to live life according to? Thank you for asking. We are to live our lives according to our assignment, not our appetite. Yeah, they don't want to have church. Let me talk to y'all. We're supposed to live our life according to our assignment, not our appetite. Right? When you start living life according to your assignment, in certain places you won't go. Not because you don't want to. Y'all don't want to be real. But because you know it doesn't match your assignment. There are some people that you won't allow yourself to be connected to. Not because you don't want to be connected to them. I just realized that's not my assignment. My assignment dictates that I can't go anywhere. I can't just do anything. I can't just be around anybody. Even though I would like to be at all the parties, I can't be there because it'll ruin my witness. I'm living my life, God help me, according to my assignment. This is why you pray when you don't feel like it, because that's your assignment. This is why you're in the Word of God studying, even though you wish you were doing something else. Why? Because it's my assignment. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? This is why you're saving your money, because your assignment in this season is to become a homeowner. This is why you're working on your credit, because your assignment in this season is to make sure you position your family so that they can get to another level that you were on when you were growing up. Don't be mad at me when I won't come certain places and when I won't do certain things and when I won't go to places I used to go. I don't think I'm better than you. I'm just living my life according to my assignment. We need to make something popular right now, assignment-based living. Can I say that again? Assignment-based living. We are to live our lives according to our assignment, not our appetite. I got to hurry. Genesis 25, 31. This is good. Jacob replied, first sell me your birthright. All right? Now, this is critical. I really want y'all to catch this, all right? Because if I see Jacob, we're going to have to fight. I'm gonna shoot the cag under Jacob. I'm going to throw hands with him, because Jacob is the type of person who I can't stand, right? Jacob sees Esau in a moment of weakness and decides to take advantage of it, all right? He sees him in a moment of weakness and he decides to take advantage of it, all right? Here's something I gotta give you, here's a warning I gotta give you, and I want you to catch this. Be careful who you allow to see you when you're hungry. Be careful who you allow to have access to you when you're empty. You got to be careful. Everybody has not earned the right to see you at your lowest point. Everybody has not earned the right to have access to me when I'm hungry. Because if you can't help me find food, why are you here? What's going on? What is this? What am I going to do with this? Right? You ever been so hungry to the point to where you were mad? You were hangry? Hungry and angry? Anything somebody said to you, if it wasn't food, you're just like, why are you talking to me? Shut up, leave me alone. You've got to be careful who has access to you when you're hungry. Because instead of simply feeding his brother, Jacob decides to position himself in such a way that he can get something out of it. God, help me. Be very careful of people who can't help you without them getting a favor out of it too. Jesus. Instead of just feeding his brother who's hungry, who's just come back in from the field, he says, okay, cool, I got something you want. What I'm getting out of this? There are people who you have unknowingly allowed access to you in seasons where your hunger and your emptiness was exposed and you got the bad end of the stick. This is crazy. This is really a lesson in decision making, because some of the worst decisions of my life I made on an empty stomach. Did y'all hear what I just said? This is a lesson in decision making, because if I'm honest, Kim, some of the worst decisions I've ever made in my life, I made them on an empty stomach. You ever went in the store hungry, straight from work, and you say, I'm only going to spend $20, $30, $40, and then you got to the register, and it said $145, because you went in there hungry. God. You ever sat down in a restaurant, Jason, and you hadn't eaten all day, and you were so hungry that everything on the menu looked good? You ordering stuff that you don't even like. Then get mad at the waitress and try to send it back. I didn't like the alligator. Can we send that back? You sat down with an empty stomach. And because your stomach was empty, you bit off more than you could chew. I'm talking to somebody. You got to stop making decisions when you're hungry. You got to stop making decisions, when you're angry. You said some things to people that you may never be able to get back because you said it in a moment when you were angry. Don't make another decision when you're hungry, when you're angry. Don't make a decision when you're lonely. God, I'm going to break somebody up today. You know you don't need to be with them. Y'all ain't got no business. Y'all ain't got no business together. Because they make your body feel good, but they make your soul feel bad. But now you're stuck with them because you made that decision when you were lonely. And now here we are pretending to be happy on Instagram because I don't want my family and my friends to know this relationship is a sham. So we're going to keep posting these cute pictures when truth be told, I'm only with you because I was lonely. Can't make decisions when you're hungry or when you're angry or when you're lonely or when you're tired. Part of the reason that Esau is willing to sell his birthright is because he showed up at the wrong place hungry, tired. And now somebody is able to take advantage of him because he's not able to make good decisions. This is why you've got to be in your word, because I believe that God's model for decision making is not simply better, it's best. It's the best way to make decisions. All right, y'all invited me out. God, is this okay? God, am I going to regret this in 6 months? Verse 32, I'm done. Look, I'm about to die, Esau said. What good is the birthright to me? I'm about to die. You can have this birthright. You want it? Okay, you want it so bad. You can have it. What good is it to me? I'm about to die anyway. Esau is failing to properly process his emotions. Because he's hungry, because he's tired, he's now become frustrated. His emotions are out of whack. He's getting ready to make an emotional decision. I've said this to you before, emotions should ride, not drive. They need to be in the car. They just don't need to be driving it. Stop allowing your emotions to make the decisions. This is so good. You cannot sacrifice your future on the altar of your feelings. Some of us are delaying the future that God has for us because we're in our feelings. He's tired. He's frustrated. He says, you know what? I'm about to die anyway. Look how melodramatic he's been. 8 hours without food is not going to kill you. Say amen or say ouch. You worked a whole shift yesterday hungry. They heard your stomach growling through your calls at work and everything. But he said, no, I'm about to die. I can't do this, man. It's been too long. I got to eat something. I'm about to die. When we're wasteful, this shows us that it's a mindset long before it's an action. Wastefulness is a mindset, Pastor Darius, long before it's ever in action. In other words, before you're ever wasteful here, you're wasteful here. Y'all didn't hear what I just said. Before you're ever wasteful with your hand, you've already been wasteful with your head. Esau is living for the moment that he's in. All right? Here's what I've learned. Blessed people live to be satisfied tomorrow, not today. We could go home right there. We could go home. When you're blessed, you learn to live for tomorrow and not today. There are some things that I've got to say no to today to preserve the blessing that's coming to me tomorrow. But instead, Esau has assigned more value to what he's going through than what he's going to. Did you hear what I just said? He's assigned more value to this temporary moment of hunger. That's what he's going through right now. Instead of looking at it and saying, no, there's something that I'm going to on the other side of this hunger. If I can hold on and make a good decision today, it can preserve what God is trying to do in my life tomorrow. I'm trying to tell somebody, don't put more value on what's going on today than what God wants to do in your life tomorrow. Are you hearing what I'm saying? No, he's assigned this value to this pain and this hunger that he's feeling right now instead of realizing that if I just hold on, I'll get filled. Blessed people refuse to give up what they want most for what they want now. When you're blessed, you make a cognitive decision to no longer give up what you want most for what you want now. I'm done. Esau has a birthright, and this birthright is not visible. It's not tangible. He can't see it. He knows something's coming, but he don't really know what it is. I got this birthright, but that don't really mean anything until my daddy dies. So it's visible, but he's decided that it's not valuable. It's visible, but he's decided that it's not valuable. I don't know who you are, where you are, but you're watching right now. I feel you in my spirit. You're tugging on me. And you've wasted some things. This whole message, you were trying to decide if you were going to keep it on or turn it off. It was just too much. I want to unlock something for you. I want to help you. I'm not telling you what I read in a book. I'm telling you what I lived through, what I know from my own experience. Is that the devil will tempt you into believing that just because something is invisible, that means it's not valuable. There's an entrepreneur, you're watching me right now, and thank you, Holy Spirit. And you're seeing everybody else's business blow up, and they're booming during a pandemic. You feel overlooked. They get hundreds of likes. You can barely get 10 or 15. And now you're tempted to believe that because they're more visible, they're more valuable. Can I help you? Visibility is not a great indicator of value. It's possible for you to be invisible and invaluable. God, you missed that. When something is invaluable, that means it's irreplaceable. You don't know what you would do without it. You would lose your mind if you didn't have it. It's possible for you to be invisible to them, but invaluable to God. Can I help you? Is value attached to your life? Is value attached to the blessings that God has put in your life? It's value attached to that anointing. It's value attached to that gifting and that calling, that creativity. There are people around the world who would do anything to have the gifts, the blessings that God has given you. And I know that because you have it, it doesn't seem like it's much, but can I help you? It's valuable. Can we take this further? You're valuable. Say that like you mean it. I'm valuable. No, say it louder. Say I'm valuable. The devil will attempt you to believe that you're not, but you are. There is an amazing value that has been attached to your life. Don't waste it. Don't waste it. That's all I came to preach was just don't waste it. The value that God has attached to your life, you better not waste it. You better not waste it. Pastor Hollis, I don't feel valuable. I don't feel like I'm that worthy. I don't feel like I'm valuable. I'm just here. Can I help you understand how valuable you are? couple thousand years ago on a hill called Calvary. God decided to pay the highest price for you that could ever be paid. If I was in the old church, I'd say how they hung him high and they stretched him wide. He hung his head, and for you, he died. Why would he do that? Why would he die for you? Can I help you? Because you're valuable. Don't waste it. Don't waste the value that God has assigned to your life. Don't waste it. Don't give away the blessing for a little pot of soup. Don't waste it. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for this moment in your presence, this moment in your word. We decree and declare now by faith. We make a decision that's going to be watered by our devotion, that when it comes to the blessing that you've put over our life, we won't waste it. That Father, even when we don't have the money, we're still blessed to have a Father who's rich in houses and land. We won't waste it. That even when we're sick in our body, we're still blessed to serve a God who is a balm in Gilead. And by his stripes, we're made healed. By his stripes, we're made whole. And so we won't waste it. God, we won't waste it. We won't waste another opportunity. We won't waste another chance. We won't waste another day. We won't waste it. Father, we repent for assuming that we deserved it and for failing to steward it and overlooking the things that you've done for us throughout our life. We repent for that. And today we decide to make a decision that we're done wasting. We're done running. We are going to make the most out of every opportunity that you've given us. We're done wasting. Father, create in us a clean heart and renewing us the right spirit so that we won't waste, but instead we'll make the most of it. So one day we can hear those words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. Now I'm gonna make you ruler over many." It's in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody who believed it said amen. Come on, if you received that word, stand to your feet really quickly. And I want you to give God praise. Come on, you can do better than that. Give God praise in this place. And while you're praising God, I got a sneaky suspicion that somebody is getting ready to make their next move, their best move. And you're going to give your life to Christ by texting HOME to 28950. Let's celebrate everybody who's coming home. Come on home, come on home. We can't wait to welcome you into our fellowship that is Rock City Church. Listen, if you're giving today, you know how to do that. I want you to be faithful over your tithe and your offering. The Lord loves a cheerful giver. When you give, when you tithe, it's a sign of a growing faith. It lets God know that he can trust you not only with what you have, but also with what he's getting ready to release to you. There's three ways you can give right there on the screen. I'm so excited that you guys are continuing to be a part of what God is doing in our church. The church building is closed, but the church has never been more open. This past week, we were able to bless 1,000 families. Come on, give God praise, man. 1,000 families were blessed with groceries due to Rock City in partnership with the Jefferson County Sheriff's Department. None of that is possible without the volunteers. Let's thank God for all the volunteers who are out there part of that. And your tithe and your offering makes all of that possible. So I want you to continue to be faithful over your tithe and your offering. Listen, we're getting ready to go. I want you to help me celebrate the best pastor in the world, our senior pastor, Pastor Mike McClure Jr. Can we show him some love, man? In the comment section, man, tag him. Let him know that you love him, that you're praying for him. Not only is he a prolific pastor, but we just found out this past week that he's also been nominated for the second year in a row for 7 stellar nominations, man. And so we're just celebrating what God is doing in and through his life. If you get a chance, man, take a second and find him on Facebook, Instagram. Give him a shout out and let him know that you love him and you're praying for him. Listen, we love you and we can't wait to see you in the morning, 7:21 a.m. for our Rock City morning devotion. Until then, we love you and we're praying for you. We'll see you soon.
Wow.
Come on.
Pastor Hollis. Wait a minute. Mighty God.
Can't waste it.
Can't waste it.
Won't waste it.
Won't waste it.
Don't waste it. Yes.
Listen, what an amazing word. Pastor Hollis, he always blesses me every time he preaches or teaches. And if he blessed you today, it's not too late to share the link. You can still share it on your Facebook page. Send it to your family, friends, post-it notes, whatever you want to do. Let people be blessed by the word that has blessed your life today.
That's so good. And, you know, maybe you are ready to take that next step. That tug that you're currently feeling at your heart, don't ignore it.
Yeah.
Go ahead and make your next move
your best move.
You can rededicate your life to Christ or come on back home by texting one word, that's home, to 28950. We have our prayer warriors and our teachers and different individuals that will be happy to follow up with you so that we can make sure that you are truly being all that God has created and designed you to be.
I love it. And if you're giving today, well, we love your support. You can do it a few ways.
Yes.
Cash App is The Rock City. That's the money sign, The Rock City. That's one of the ways I give, and you're our text to give.
I always text, so you know, you can text iRock $1 million. I'm gonna go ahead and speak it into
my
the atmosphere,
God, my God.
To 28950.
Yes, now family, don't forget tomorrow morning we will be Devo, 7:21 a.m.
Let's go.
Central Time.
Yes.
Diving into the Word of God. You do not want to miss it. Make sure you join us on YouTube or Facebook. Until next time, family, we love you. God bless you. Peace.
Peace.